Actually, this 1 hour I'll try to cover the vitamin B deficiencies and their effect on the brain structure, microstructure, and brain function. Now, what we find in this country as well as the rest of the world is that vitamin B12 and B1, they are very commonly deficient in individuals. Yes. And the belief for the B12 deficiency you see more in vegetarians than non-vegetarians, elderly who don't take much meal, they don't have enough means to take those things, and that's why they are deficient, and they develop dementias, early dementia or something. To that extent, even Alzheimer's disease, people say the B12 is associated with the Alzheimer's. And one of the things people try to do is to add B12 to their treatment, beside the standard treatment of Alzheimer's disease. Similarly, it has been shown in the neonates and children who are dependent on the milk from the breast, not taking the dairy-rich B12 milk. So they are the one who also get deficiency in B12. The mother is deficient, the child gets deficient. And elderly age groups, the adult age group is the one which is not very much studied. Most of the work has been done on the developing brain as well as the extremes of age, but not in the one which are adult. And mostly these patients come to you with some neurological deficit. They come with sensory problems, some weakness of the limbs, and very, very, very non-specific things, you know, which if a good neurologist is there, he picks up the things and he asks for a B12, he asks for imaging, and imaging may not always be very productive, you know, in answering these questions. And that's the reason I thought this is one area which is easily correctable, have an impact on the cognition. And no, cognition has not been studied in the adult population with B12. It has been studied in elderly. There are a lot of studies from the West which have with their cohorts of elderly, they do all kind of things. And the same with the B1. The thiamine deficiency is very common. It's very common, people say, even in the West. What effect it has, and a lot of alcoholics have thiamine deficiency. People who take alcohol, they have a liver disease, they have liver damage, and they have thiamine. And Wernicke encephalopathy, which you all know as a psychologist, Wernicke's Korsakoff syndrome, and that is very commonly associated with or Marchifava-Biglami's disease, where again there is a thiamine is associated with that. So I thought I'll combine thiamine. We have done some work with thiamine. Dr. Rathore and me have worked, and we quantified the blood thiamine level, which is very difficult to quantify. No lab does that actually. So we struggled. We had a grant from ICMR. We struggled a lot initially in how to quantify. We tried different methods, different means, and we bought a column. We had to send it back. It's not working properly in HPLC. And finally, we found a method which is more easily doable, and we quantified and we published that work actually. So with this, I start with the B12 to begin with, and then I move to the B6 little bit, and just to give you an idea how those so innocuous vitamins can cause havoc to your, you know, systems, and without you realizing that it's the cause of the problem. So we all know the vitamin B12 necessary for normal red blood cell formation, and its deficiency can lead to the macrocytic anemia. That's a classic thing which occurs, is the size of the RBC increases. They call it a macrocytic anemia, and one of the subcomponent of macrocytic is the megaloblastic anemia. It is also involved in the tissue repair and the DNA synthesis. It's a cofactor, coenzyme to many of the things, you know, from the chemical point of view. It is known to cause widespread neurological symptoms and widespread psychiatric manifestation, usually attributed to the abnormal myelin synthesis. So it is the wires, the connecting wires, which get defective. And this is one of the reasons we try to study the wires in our study, and to see that how the wires get affected. Even when on a standard imaging, they look absolutely normal. Now, it is involved, as you mentioned, in the hematopoiesis, that's the blood formation, cellular growth, and its deficiency can lead to serious neural damage and because and can cause tingling and numbness of the hands and the limbs. That is a typical presentation. People call it as a peripheral neuropathy or a psychological problem. There's no problem. The imaging is normal. You know, so these are the ones who get tossed around, and they really have serious problems. There are very few reports which mention the reversibility of leukoencephalopathy of the brain. Only once in a while you find a report, case note, where you find there were changes in the brain which were like white matter changes, and they reversed with B12 injection. But everybody who gets those kind of changes is not a B12, and everybody with B12 hardly has a change in the brain. 99% of patients, sufferers of B12 deficiency, hardly have changes which is visible on imaging of the brain. So it means it's a disease difficult to, and the only way to prove is by doing the level, blood levels. So this is how the pathology starts. It begins with demyelination, axonal degeneration, and irreversible damage. If the damage becomes too extensive, then reversibility is not there. It may not reverse, especially in the spinal cord. The limb may not come back to normal. They may still have some deficiency left, because once the neurodegeneration occurs, after the axonal degeneration occurs, then it becomes difficult to repair. Brain, spinal cord, optic nerve, and the peripheral nerves can be affected. Conventional MRI rarely shows brain white matter, as I mentioned to you, and the changes are mostly in the spinal cord, if at all. So that is why we thought, let us look at the tractography and look at the microstructural changes in the fiber bundles, how they behave, and how they are different from the normal brain parenchyma in a B12 deficiency, even when they are absolutely looking normal on imaging. Now this is a classic example of how do you look at the B12 deficiency. Can you? Okay. So this is what happens is that if you look at the posterior part of the cord, if you can see here, this is definitely brighter than the anterior part of the cord. And if you look at the axial view, you find the posterior columns, the posterolateral columns are abnormal. And this is what, if you know as a psychologist, this is called as a subacute combined degeneration of the cord in the bidimensional. This is the classical picture of B12 deficiency. But this classical picture is seen in about 10 to 12% of the patients with the clinical symptoms. Majority of the patients have a normal, some have very extensive, some have cord atrophy. But this picture is there, definitely I can say as a radiologist, this is a subacute combined degeneration of the cord, no differential diagnosis. But this picture is rarely, you know, visible in the B12 deficiency. Now this is what is the white matter changes I was talking about. You get a gross white matter changes. You can see this absolutely bright signal all around, and when you treat them, they tend to regress. This is a classic picture of the B12, and this is seen once in your lifetime. So you don't see it every day, you know. And if I see that, I cannot say this is B12. I cannot say this is B12, okay, because this is so non-specific of the white matter damage. It can occur in anything and everything. So I call it like a toxic demyelination, I may call it as a metabolic demyelination, I will not call it a B12 deficiency, because this is not a typical feature of B12 deficiency. Now what we have done is, we have done some of the standard neuropsychological tests, which are adult verified in the Indian population, not particularly in Lucknow population, but this is what we all get as a kids. And this is what we have done, the digital symbol, the number connection, the picture completion, block design, picture arrangement, object assembly, figure connection. And the figure connection were designed by us, because the number connection is the one which is used for people who are educated, they know 1, 2, 3, 4. But the figure connection is the one which is used for uneducated, who are illiterate. When I joined HPGI, there was a guy called Dr. Nayak, who was interested in hepatic encephalopathy, and he converted the number connection into a figure connection test, validated in large population, in the healthy population as well as the hepatic encephalopathy population. And we, now this is the standard test, we accept it worldwide in people who are not educated, who can read the things, and that is where the test became available. Now this is one example. Now this is the method of tractography which was designed by Dr. Latour, and it is a very, very objective method of segmenting the white matter tracts. Because if you draw with your hands, there will be some kind of subjectivity and the reproducibility will not be there. So I was telling him all the time that I will not accept any test which has subjectivity. If I draw true fibers extra, I will get the higher FA value. If I get two fibers less, I get less FA value. So then he came out with an automatic segmentation method by which you could segment the, just click the area and the whole fibers comes out. Make two clicks, the whole fibers connect to come out. So that is the contribution which he has made to the DTI. He has published, he is the first author of the technical paper he has, and we have published a lot of the clinical part of with him, along with him. So this method gives you all the fibers. You can see the singular SLF, ILF, IFO and the phonix. So beautifully shown. And this is what we are trying to show is in the patients who are B12 deficiency and they are being treated in the NDIC. So this is a group of patients who was had a B12 deficiency, proven B12 deficiency, on homocysteine was high. The B12 deficiency means the B12 has to be low. Even if the MMA or B12, if the MMA is low, high, and the B12 is low, we still normal, we may or may not be there. But B12 low is a definite way to say it's a B12 deficiency. So what we did was we just compared the data of the different fiber bundles available, which we could do by the Latour's method of tractography. And we could actually see, look at the motor fibers, and look at this motor fibers, and that's the sensory fibers. Very nicely you can see the different colors. ATR, PTR, STR in the healthy. And when I use the word healthy, very interesting thing I will talk about here is, see, I always believe that people, we all in the lab are healthy, you and me are healthy. So I think just came to mind that some are vegetarian, some are non-vegetarian, so why not you do the B12, because we were in the hospital where the staff had a free access to the B12 level without paying anything. So all the staff members were coming to us for this test as a volunteer, so we decided to do their B12 and the homocysteine levels. And we were surprised, quite a good number of people had B12 deficiency. So that made me realize that we should not take the individual healthy based on they are healthy on the clinical examination. This should be because the cognition is not picked up. The finer cognition, like the voice test or something which you do, they are like fine testing. They are not like the gross motor or gross, intelligence, IQ or something, you know, which is grossly abnormal, you can say, well, they are normal. Or the gross course which you do, that mini mental function test or something. So they are not the one which are having, they have fine changes. That is what is important actually in terms of cognition in this individual. So I decided to drop those patients from the list. I didn't do further analysis of those patients. I was concentrating on the patient and the control who are having a normal B12. That became a definition for me to take the normal B12. So these controls are actually truly B12 normal. So that is the one I want to emphasize here. And that gave me an idea that we discussed in the last 2 days with Dr. Brajbhushan, that something which is going on, we don't know what is going on with us. And once a guy is having a poor MMS, MMSC or poor IQ, so you don't have to do a rocket science to define them, right? Only when there is a fine changes in the cognition is there, like mathematical skills, for example, just to give an example. So that is where the difference may come in. I don't know. I mean, you guys have to do all these things to design those kind of methodologies to know how we can do that. Now this is a callosum. Just click the thing, everything comes out of this. This is all beautifully, you know, tapetum, lamellisci, MCP. And when we quantified, what we found was, you could see the significant changes, you know, in the different fibers. I mean, it's a pretty busy slides. And there are two measures we do in the DTI, which is, I think you should be interested not only in the fMRI, but tractography as a psychologist. Because if you have a good light and there is a wall in between, then you can't see the light coming through, right? So I think the message has to be conveyed through the tracts, whatever function you are trying to assess. And I think that's where the role of, if the hand is not moving, what function are you going to assess, right? Then people do passive movement, this movement. That is not equivalent to the motor movement. So the bundles are defective, right? The conduction is not there. So I think for a psychologist, my request is that look at the tract sensor. Don't think that fMRI is the end of the world, and try to develop a connectome theory, like connecting the function and the wires together. Because you can have a good power coming in, but there is no wire is short, the light is not going on the room. So I think wire is as important as the source of light. So that is what I wanted to convey. It's a very, very important message. And if you look at this, what we are finding is that there are changes in all the tracts, most of the tracts, suggesting thereby B12 is a disease, or what you call is affecting the central nervous system. The spinal cord may manifest first, but changes are in all the white matters, as you can see from these, you know, studies that MD and the FA, which are the measure of those things, and they are. And look at the neuropsych test. These are the tests which are abnormal in these individuals, you know. This is surprising, you know, that you have changes which are obviously abnormal. And these are the numbers which clearly show the significant difference, you know. If you look at all the texts are showing. So disease is not confined to like the posterior column of the spinal cord. It is, because it shouldn't be. Why should a particular segment be when there is a defect in myelination, or it is affecting the myelination? It should affect the whole myelination of the brain, the nervous system. So that is what we are trying to prove. This has not been done earlier. That's why I'm very excited about the study. We have taken adult population, and we have taken the cognition adult population, B12 levels, and not only see the spinal cord, we have seen the brain, which is normal looking on imaging. So this is a very, very significant study. I mean, whomsoever I've shown worldwide, they're very excited, you know. I think we should put the best channel on something. This is what I'm working on. I can read through that. Now this is another example of look at the neuropsych, you know, PC, DS, BD, all are showing gross changes, you know, in this. Now this is an interesting thing from the point of view of the pre and post therapy. You find the changes are reversing, you can see that. This is pre and the post in the different fiber bundles. Changes are seen in the diffusivity, and the neuropsychological changes are reversing. It means that these guys apparently are not normal. They're not normal in cognition, and which can be reconfirmed by the microstructural change in the brain. That's what I'm trying to say. So we quantified the area which is usually affected by the B12 and the functions which are connected to the wires. Those we have found out. So this is the kind of correlation we have seen, and some of the tests you can see here show significant correlation, you know, with the our standard fibers, showing the significant changes, you know. I mean, there are huge number of fibers, and some of them are definitely showing the significant changes. Now that is how a brain looks like on imaging. If you look at this brain, it is a perfect looking brain on T2, and if you look at the DTI maps also, they don't show any gross changes unless you quantify. And if you quantify by putting the regions of interest in A, B or C and all these things, it is very cumbersome. And we don't know which all fibers are affected. So I think that is where we use this methodology of quantify the bundles rather than quantifying the region of interest, actually. Get the whole bundle out is the difference. And we hypothesize that we should have a defect in myelination affecting all the fibers, not only one or two or three fibers. Now this is the one which I wanted to share with you. This data is based on about 55 patients where we have used technology. Where we have used the FSL technique, Duke registration, MNI template, whatever I talked to yesterday, this is absolutely done using VBM analysis. Everything has been done in this. Methodology is as per the design of the West. But patient belongs to India, the design is Western. You know. And what is interesting you find is, this is the TBSS, track-based statistical analysis. The green are the green thing which you are seeing are the structure, which are the fiber structure. That is how they define. The green area which you are seeing is the fiber defined structures. Now, the yellow areas are the one which are significantly different from the control. So, you can see how much white matter is different, you know, from the control. Look at the cerebellum, look at the midbrain. So, wherever the white matter is there, it is clearly showing abnormality. Okay, this is important. Now, I think you can draw your own conclusion. Is it the cortex which is important for neurocognition, or it is the white matter also is important? I'm not sure you really guys bother about white matter anymore. You only bother about the cortex. So, another message which I'm trying to give to this methodology is that the white matter is as important as the cortex. And if you look at the cortices, the difference are very obvious, and this is the highest significance. The yellow represents the maximum differences which are observed, and red represents the lower part, you know, the significance goes down as a function of color. This look at the singular fibers. I mean, it's unbelievable. Callosum, which we mentioned in the tractography, the same fibers are actually seen. Even with tractography, still you will say, well, you clicked it, you were right or not, Rutter was wrong, it didn't do the right kind of tractography. So, all criticism can be done. But even by an alternative method, we are finding similar results. What are you finding? So, that shows the power of the methodology being used by Rutter versus the standard method used worldwide. And it confines to the hypothesis which we have. The myelination defect is there irrespective of the area of the brain. And it has relationship with the functionality of the brain. That is what you want to convey. Now, this is another method we use. And if you look at the changes in the FA, which is a much sensitive measure of the fiber bundles, than the MD, mean diffusivity. And the mean diffusivity is showing the similar changes in some of the areas, like this area is temporal area, is confining to temporal area here. And look at the external capsule with the external capsule here, the occipital tracts here, some of the occipital tracts here. This is interesting. And what is interesting is the radial diffusivity. See, we did the radial and the axial diffusivity also. There are a number of parameters you can take to understand the microstructural change in the brain. And the radial diffusivity was definitely showing much closer relationship with FA, if you look at this, as compared to the mean diffusivity. So, you can just see that a normal looking brain on conventional MRI, even on a conventional DTI, can be unrewarding. And how this methodology, they are independent methodologies. We are not doing anything, we are not putting anything extra here and there. It is an automatic approach. 40 brains, 50, this is 57 brains data and 47 controls, it is not a small number. So, how beautifully you can demonstrate the changes in different fiber bundles using different methodologies, I mean that is important. And if you just look at the neuropsych in the same group of patients, like this is another one group, this is another group actually. And we find the digit symbol, number connection, picture compliance, all are showing changes. You can see that p values are different. The cortex is okay, because this study can design the cortex as well as the white matter. It is the white matter bundle which is affected in this. And we know from the basic science that how the B12 affects the brain function. So, it is matching with what has been talked about 50 years back, 100 years back. It confirms to that what we are saying. And it shows the cognition deficit, you know, is there. So, that is pretty interesting. Now, then we did the correlation studies. Now, this is one way of doing the correlation. Now, today with the FSL methods, you can actually put your cognition test and define the area vis-a-vis where the cognition correlation is coming, significant correlation. And look at the FA and the DS, digit symbol. That showed correlation with a number of areas in the brain. Can you see that? Brainstem, temporal lobes, cerebellum, cingulum, the frontal white matter, external capsule, occipital area. So that's the kind of relationship that the digit symbol had with this. So you can define your areas, you know, on the brain directly through this methodology. So you don't have to guess from which area is connectivity is coming for that particular test. So that is something I liked about this, and this is very powerful, become very powerful in terms of understanding the psychology with this. Now, when we looked at the correlation with the FA with the NCT, these are two tests which are showing correlation. We tried three or four. We didn't try all of these. It takes a lot of time. It takes about 2 to 3 days to do each analysis. High computation method is required. And you could see this is the area, the cingulum area showing you the negative correlation with the FA, the number connection test. And the rest was not showing that. This is combining the control and the patient together. Now, this is looking at the correlation between the NPT and the RD, the negative correlation of radial diffusivity with the DS. And you can see similar area what I showed you earlier. Like less as compared, exactly similar to what we are seeing in the changes which we are seeing in the RD values compared to the FA values. Similar correlations are seen in the similar areas. So look at the reproduction, the correlation, and look the reproduction of the whole thing, you know, which you are seeing here in this. Now, positive correlation with the RD and the NCT. These are the two areas, cingulum, which you can see, and part of this occipital zone or the auditory area, which is showing you some changes. And these are the green color shows the tracts. Now, then what we did was we tried to get those numbers out from the regions and try to look for the correlation with the digit symbol and with the radial diffusivity, exactly same thing what you say. And there is actually, which you can see, the numbers also coming out correctly, what you are saying, except in this particular thing, the triangle is patient. In this thing, I was finding that the control is not showing the relationship, but patient still showed the relationship, the triangle. So what I am trying to say is that you go back and forth, you do ROI analysis the same way, again you find changes. So you just take the global picture, put the ROI individual patient from the same region, and again you find the changes are there. So you can always confirm by any methodology, it is there. It is not a false, it is not something which is coming from somewhere. It is not just a matter of chance you got this, it is actually there. So that is what is important. So that is why it took us 3 to 4 months to do a rigorous analysis, no? Because when we had somebody coming from US, he said, oh, why not to check the ROI also and see whether they are correct or not. You to be doubly sure what is there. Everybody wants to have his doubt and he wants to be sure what we are talking about, and it turned out to be right. It is a very extensive kind of exercise, but it is worth doing it because it gives you answers. So this is a part of the story I wanted to cover with you with respect to the B12. I think this is something which should be the futuristic way to understand how the B12, the technology may not be available to you at this point in time in the field, but the proof of the technology, the proof of the concept is there in terms of technology. Neuropsych versus microstructural change in the brain. So that is what is significant. And B12 is something which is not uncommon to have a deficiency. I think about 30 to 40% of the population, they say what you see is not even the tip of the iceberg. So you see a huge population which may be neglected. And like calcium and vitamin D, same way the B12 is the one which is responsible. So moving quickly to another area which interests us also is the thymine, which is again as common as that. If you look at the literature, thymine is as common as B12. Maybe more common. But when you only know from the history the Wernicke psychosis, corsical psychosis, and you know the Marchibar-Bignami syndrome. There are two things you know which are seen only once in a lifetime. Now, we all knew that thymine deficiency, see why I became interested in thymine deficiency, there is a reason for that. when we were working on the thiamine deficiency, not working on thiamine deficiency, I happened to spend some time at UCLA, and my student, who was also a student, Dr. Latour, Rajesh, and he showed me the data of the obstructive sleep apnea. He wanted to look at the data from the radiologist point of view. Do you have any changes in the brain in this before they write a paper actually? So they wanted a validation of the normality of the brain, typically done by all basic scientists. So I was looking at the data, I said, well, I don't find happy with the mammillary body. They don't look size, they are subnormal in size. And I just pointed out a number of times, yes, I think this is abnormal, this is not normal, this is not normal, look inside. So he told the supervisor, who was a very well-known neuroscientist, he said, if Dr. Gupta said, let us verify that. And he decided to develop a software methodology and quantify the volume of the mammillary body objectively rather than subjectively. And once he found there was significant difference in the volume versus the control, he got very excited, and we had a paper in Neuro Report on this, I don't remember exactly. I was one of the co-authors. He put me as a co-author because I picked up the findings actually. So he had no reason to not to keep me in that paper, and he put that. So then I realized, why not look at our patients of the hepatic encephalopathy who are non-alcoholic cirrhosis. Alcoholic, we all know, you know, they will have thiamine, so you give thiamine, no issue with that. And that was the genesis of this whole work. See, I started from somewhere else, and I went to look at the thiamine. And our paper are the first paper in the world actually on this, by the way, I should tell you that. Now, we know the most common cause of thiamine deficiency is a poor intake in the food, reduced absorption in small bowel, including alcohol abuse, crash dieting, and renal dialysis. These are the standard methods available for thiamine deficiency. Patient with kidney failure and dialysis who do a crash course in dieting because they have their own method of, you know, doing this. It's a major factor in the metabolism of glucose. Known that ingestion of simple carbohydrate processed in the body mainly to glucose automatically increases the need for a dietary thiamine. Deficiency of thiamine results in axonal loss, Wernicke's disease, peripheral neuropathy, alteration of memory, and the cerebral degeneration. This we know from our Wernicke's encephalopathy or Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome, you know, which is histologically proven. Everybody has shown histology and all this. The guys who described their names have this, so they showed it on histology. You know. In fact, I had a big debate with one of the groups actually. I was in Spain giving a talk on this. So they were pretty excited, very critical also, as usual, you know. Now, imaging findings are known. If you see them, they are there. You can say that, yes, they are there. There is no problem with that. Alteration in the signal intensity in the mammillary body, the medial thalami, periaqueductal area, and selective involvement of the cranial nerve, cerebellum, red nuclei, dented nuclei, fornix, splenium, cerebral cortex, and the basal ganglia. And they characterize the non-alcoholic, that is what they say, non-alcoholic Wernicke's encephalopathy syndrome. I had a patient actually who came from Gorakhpur. She was a medico, she was a gynecologist. She had, I think, something like for 1 week she continuously doing deliveries, you know, she had so many deliveries in nursing home. She didn't take her meal properly, and she came in coma to King George Medical College with an MRI, and then they brought the MRI to me. I said, looks like a Wernicke's encephalopathy. And then I did repeat MRI at my place, and I said, well, looks like Wernicke's, it doesn't look like JP. JE is very common in that area, and JE doesn't affect the mammillary body. I said, this is definitely looks like Wernicke's encephalopathy. She was given vitamin B1, and next day, third day I saw that the same boy in a corridor with a girl. I said, how is your wife? Yes, she is there. So that's the kind of response, you know, if you are aware of the methodology, if you are aware of the conditions, and if you can pick up a disease, that's the difference. The woman was in coma. She was standing next to him, and I asked her, how is your wife? He said, oh, she's fine. We gave her thiamine, she got up. So that's the kind of response you get. So what I'm trying to say, it's an important deficiency. It can cause havoc to your life and it can be devastating. So I think it's important for us to ambient the falling volumes are reduced in conditions such as obstructive sleep apnea, which because this is a paper from Kumar, okay, and metabolic, this is a paper from us, Mandal, metabolic brain disease, and sleep apnea and Alzheimer's. This is what they've shown. Alzheimer's has been, everything has been implicated in them because we don't know what is Alzheimer's, so we say everything is Alzheimer's, right? B12, B1, B6, calcium, and everything is vitamin D, everything is involved in this. You know. MB receives the fibers from the hippocampus via the fornix, send efferent to the anterior dorsal thalami, and are essential to route the signal between the brain areas and integrate the memory function. So, I think this is what the, this is from the brain behavioral sciences. The importance of this apparatus, hippocampal apparatus, that's very important for memory and, you know, cognition. We all know that, right? And thymine affects that. MRI, if you have Wernicke's encephalopathy, yes, it's a good tool, it can tell you, but every patient doesn't have Wernicke's encephalopathy. However, it is not abnormal in all subjects with Wernicke's encephalopathy, thymine deficiency, you know. If you see, it's fine, if you don't see, it's not fine. That's another problem, you know. The measurements of amyloid body with the MRI provides a means of identifying the cases of Wernicke's during the life. It means it is not easy to define Wernicke's encephalopathy in the absence of quantifying the volume of the mammillary body or the signal change in the mammillary body. This has been commented by these guys from radiology. Now, this is the method I was telling you, that Rutter developed, segmenting automatically the fibers. And this is how typically you see the Wernicke's, you know, the cortical involvement, the mammillary body involvement, the thalami, the medial thalami involvement, very classic of the Pontis, Vici Pontis involvement, very classic of Wernicke's. Now, this is what we did. We took the patient of acute liver failure, very interesting, acute liver failure, acute and chronic liver failure and controls. And this is the control and very interesting, ACLF, ALF, and as you go down, this is the one which is showing the maximum reduction size of the mammillary volume. And the chronic liver failure. So, we had a control, chronic liver failure, acute liver failure, and acute and chronic liver failure. So, acute liver failure is the one which causes sudden reduction in the size of the mammillary body, not the chronic, in a patient who is on alcoholic cirrhosis. This is all non-alcoholic. And what we did was, we actually did the tectography, look at the fornix, in control, ACLF and the ALF, that's the fornix bundle. And we quantified the thymine levels in the controls, ACLF and ALF. ALF showed the, ALF is the one, you know what is ALF is? Acute liver failure. The person develops a sudden loss of the liver volume because of acute infection in the liver like hepatitis A is the one which is commonly caused the liver shrinkage, but sometimes B also can cause C doesn't cause that much. So, and which is very common. As the rain starts coming, Kanpur, you know, is the worst area for liver disease, liver failure, because of water contamination. And look at the thymine concentration and the mammillary body volume relationship, the fornix volume and the thymine relationship, and more beautifully in the ALF than the ACLF. Look at the ALF and the ACLF. Both are there, but you can see the difference, you know. And this is a interesting story about children. We had children who actually come for acute liver failure. They have no question of alcohol. They are like 10 years, 8 years, 9 years, you know. And this is their profile at the diagnosis time, at the follow-up and the second follow-up. We followed this patient till 6 months. And if you look at the liver enzyme, they are absolutely normal. They become more or less, you know, perfect. But they still suffer from abnormalities, continue to suffer the form abnormalities. Now, this was the clinical profile. This is what all we did in these patients. It's always published actually. And we quantify the IL-6, the immune cytokines, chemokines, IL-6, TNF-alpha, and the thymine levels in all these controls. And you find as they recover, the thymine level improves. Okay. Now, liver is a very interesting part. Why liver shrinkage should cause the thymine deficiency? The patient comes to you in coma. The liver shrinks very quickly. We are not supplementing thymine when the guy is not eating anything. It's sufficient the food, if you take a food sufficiently. And you don't supplement thymine while the patient is in coma. So the liver stores quickly declines. And that's why this decline in the thymine is there. As the liver begins to come back, the thymine begins to come back. The moral of the story is you must inject thymine over here. Even if the liver is going down, the thymine level should be there, you know, to maybe that's the reason that to improve the functionality of the children at later date. Now, this is the mean diffusivity values in all the regions. This is CS values. And this is a neuropsychological test. Look at the neuropsych test. First time we could not do because patient was in coma. As he recovered 6 weeks, that's at 6 weeks, and this is 6 months. Look at the recovery. Even though it has not reached the normalcy in terms of, you know, but child has recovered. And you can see the relationship of this. This is published already, this work. So what I'm trying to tell you in other words is how important this small you know, things are like thymine and B12, calcium, which people don't care. And for a normal individual, in the medical terminology, I call it, the person can walk, he can eat, he can talk, he is normal. But that's not true. There is much more to normal than what we see, and this is what all we see. So I think this is what we should. The moral story is that this is not something uncommon. This is seen wherever we are. And I think if you can help this guy by getting the B complex or thymine or calcium, you know, nutritional supplements. So that is where it is going to make a better quality of cognition and better quality of life to the individuals. I think this is all what I want to say about the vitamin deficiencies and the cognition, you know. And it is important.
Basically, in your hospital experiment, when the staff was called, and you found that in many of the apparent normal population, there was deficiency of these vitamins. So, is it not possible that in across the entire population, some of us might be deficient in at least some aspect of nutrition, some nutritious thing? So, why not? I mean, we have a general profiling of all the individuals and then see. The impact of.
See, I'll give you a very interesting story. If you go to the US, you find that they find every material, food ingredient supplemented, you know, with iron, with B12, with B1, all the kind of things, you know, supplementation is there. In this country, the supplementation is only there for the iodine. This is by law. Because a lot of hue and cry was made by Allen Institute of Medical Sciences, did conduct a huge number of studies, Kuchipalli, and he showed that iodine is important, like mental retardation, iodine, you know, must be knowing all. Gorakhpur area was the one which was a very famous belt for iodine deficiency and goiter. And it became a law, and it became like you, everybody, every time you get an iodine salt, you know, you hear in the newspaper and the TV also, you know. But somehow these areas have not been taken seriously, neither by the nutritionist nor by psychologist, and we don't come into picture. By mistake I am doing this because that's not our sport. So I am nobody in the picture. My interest was in nutrition from the point of view. I come from a country which is deficient in nutrition. You can see a lot of kuposi, whatever they call it in Hindi, you know, malnutrition is there in this country. And this is a part of malnutrition, what we are handling. So the quality of human beings are dependent on the quality of food they take. It may not be in terms of like a burger or something. It may be standard roti and dal and chawal, But they should be have a good supplementation. They should have a proper food, and that is what is required to make them good human beings. Good means good in intellect, good in functions. See, we want population who should be good in intellect and function. I'm not sure whether the criminals come from which background and what they have or something. That's another story you can think about. Why certain people have, you know, different frontal lobe than the other guys? Is the nutrition has something to do with it? We don't know about this. Nobody has done this. Nobody thought about this, it seems. But this is one area I thought it would be a good point to excite the psychologists to get into this area and to understand why it is happening. Rather than going into typical ADHD, this, that, which is a standard care, practice care, you know, in neuropsychology. And that doesn't give you anything. What gives you importance is if you can define these problems in a population and resolve these problems and maybe create in the next 5-10 years a legislation, the supplementation of vitamin B12, thiamine, this is what is required in this country. I'm the odd man to talk about this because I'm a radiologist. I'm not a clinician, not a nutrition, I'm not a psychologist. I cannot talk about this. I can only give you what I can do, the proof of concept. The rest you guys have to take forward and do this. I have a data actually on this study also on connectivity, which I have not analyzed, FC, the functional connectivity data. So I want to write a grant actually of a connectome and the B12. That's what I'm trying to propose. That if you can do a connectome and B12, and that's the way to go actually, and get to understand how this whole thing, you know, and I'll be happy if you could be a part of us and we could involve you as a part of our study. Of course, Rathod will be there, you could also be a part of our study. Where we could at least ask you to provide us the right kind of test which we should perform in this patient. You want to design certain tests for us, and that's where it is important to, and I'll certainly put you as one of the co-investigator of the study, which we are trying to get from in the US forum. And it's important, it's relevant to this country. Nobody talks about this. Everyone talks about standard, who care about schizophrenia or OCD, or, no, these are standard things which you have been doing for ages, you know. Talk something different, you know, which you and me have not heard of. And I'm sure most psychologists don't think about B12 or a B1.
A little different thing. By extension, I mean the one thing that we're focusing is malnutrition. Why cannot it also be then that living in a polluted city for a longer period? I mean, even that maybe can have an impact on your cognitive functions for an extended.
See, when you say the polluted city, no, I understand. I understand what you're saying. No, arsenic is one which is known to affect the brain function. Lead is another one affect the brain function. But if you look at the blood levels of arsenic, they are not high in, like, for example, in Kanpur. They're not high in Lucknow. There's small area in Lucknow where we had some arsenic problem issues, you know. Where the fluorine is high, they say the arsenic is also high in some areas, you know, in Unnao. But that's all. But B12 is something which is like, you know, pollution in general, in the air pollution, if you're saying it's water pollution, air pollution, all these are important. And how the air pollution is affecting the brain, I cannot say anything about this at this point. But this is something I will level, I can show that. You know, it affects the respiratory function. People talk about the air pollution, but certainly not talked about the brain function. But this has a proven track record of the myelin synthesis, myelin requirement, carbohydrate metabolism, brain function. These are standard things, you know, which we are talking about, which we know from our 100 years story of histology, brain autopsies, brain functions. You know, we are not like that. But this is no way. This is a way to prove that. There has to be a way to prove that. There's something we are not, we are reinventing it. We are not saying that we have invented it. we are revisiting the area which was told by our forefathers, you know, how it happens. I'm not doing something different. Only thing, I'm rediscovering the same story in a different fashion. That's all I'm talking about. And makes sense.